Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. It's Richard Edelman. I'm in New York, and this is the Edelman Trust Barometer Spring Update. Our title is A World in Trauma. So the study was done in the period April 30th to May 11th. As usual, we did 1,200 respondents per country. We did 14 nations, as stated in the deck. The elites are the people 25 to 64, college plus, top 25% of income, media attentives, and the other 82% of the population is the mass population. So the first big finding of the year is an unequal recovery. And what do we mean by that? Well, what we mean is, in fact, that we see increased trust inequality between the elites, whose trust is going up, and the mass population flatlined. And we're particularly concerned about four countries: Saudi, the US, France, and the UK, which are now in the 21 to 24 point trust gap between mass and elite. These are record numbers in many countries of the gap. And that means more populism, more disconcerted people who potentially could turn into Gilets Jaunes or others. If you take a look at this laterally, what you see is that, in fact, during the height of the pandemic, the trust gap closed because mass population went up. More or less, mass population then went down for January and has continued low. And meanwhile, the elites are really happy with a soaring stock market and the potential for global recovery. In fact, the elites are less affected by pandemic-related issues, partly because of also the results of pandemic didn't affect them as much personally. They had shots. They were taking care of themselves. They could lock themselves down. The mass had to go to work. Okay. These trust gaps differ across the four institutions. You'll remember that ours is an aggregate score of business, NGOs, government, and media. The largest gap is for media. This is a watch out for business. The largest gap is for business. It's a watch out for the private sector. So again, 78 versus 58 for business. Now, government is a sad story. Government is underperforming. It has a lot to do with vaccination, but it also has to do with education, delivery of healthcare more broadly, and a sense of continued rise of inequality. The only four countries in the world where government are trusted is all in Asia or the Middle East. Again, generally, democracies have low trust in government. My employer is the most trusted institution. This is a continuation of trend. Trust has moved from top down to peer-to-peer about 10 years ago to local in the last 2 years. Local meaning in my company, in my employer, in my CEO. This has big implications for expectations of business to speak up. Again, nearly a 20-point gap with the government, higher than that for media. Okay, what's the pandemic's legacy? A world awash in fear. It's not just health related to COVID. Specifically, in most of the countries, two-thirds of the people still feel they're in a pandemic. They're still of that mindset. The only country where we saw a significant change was in the U.S., a 11-point decline in pandemic mindset from mid-60s to 56. More or less, though, people are still scared. I want you to have a sense of the dimension of this. In the next slide, what you see is that, in fact, the vaccination does not, I underline, does not significantly change how people are feeling. This is a problem for business. Please go back one. This is a big problem for business because we are all expecting a big boom. What this data would say is people are darn cautious about travel, about going to the workplace. 34% without a vax, 37% with a vax. That's hardly any movement at all. That's a stunning finding. Next. Go back, please. There's a big fallout from this pandemic related to mental health. Some of us have experienced this at home, but when 55% of the people, and this was universal across the countries, more or less say, this is the big new fear. You'll remember, as of January, it was all about, I'm going to lose my job because I'll be replaced by a machine. The result of that will be declining income, worsening economic disparity. But the new fears are actually societal fears, mental health, falling behind in education. It's not financial alone anymore. It's also societal. Further, we see that people prioritize climate change. This is a big shift in a year. Everyone was focused on personal health. Now they're focused on climate change and lack of quality information. We're in an information crisis. Also, pay attention. Those of us who have enjoyed the benefits of global trade, another consequence of the pandemic is nationalism. We do not any longer believe in products supplied by other countries. We don't want to be reliant on PPE from China, if you're in the US, for example. We also see deep concern about another pandemic. We've just gotten through this one. We're starting to hear about new variants from India or other countries, and will our vaccines work? More or less, between concerned and fearful, it's 7 in 10 people. So again, we have a big hangover from this pandemic. And why is this so consequential, this lack of leadership? Because we just don't know who to believe. Key societal leaders, whether religious, government, journalists, or even normal CEOs, we don't trust them. Who do we trust? Experts, scientists, doctors, also my employer CEO. Again, it's critical that you appreciate for your companies the importance of CEOs speaking up at this moment in time. So, the infodemic. There is no end to this. For those of us in communications, this is a sad story. Trusted news sources remain at record lows. The decline in mainstream media from the peak, when it was seen as doing a great job a year ago, to the valley today is 17 points. In the West, in democracies, it's in the 30s or 40s. Social media in the West is in the 20s. So, in short, we don't really trust any media organizations. Why? Because we believe basically that media has failed to counter disinformation or to reduce misleading information. It is more true of traditional media in the developing markets and of social media in the developed markets. There's a big call for government on this score. Who's credible? Again, it's experts, but it's also the horizontal axis, your peers, person like yourself, and finally, my employer CEO. So it's a trifecta. Experts, my friends or family, peers, and last is my employer. Who's not credible? Journalists, 36%. Government officials, 39%. Pretty darn low. So moving along, employer media, this is a shocking finding. Employer media is more believable than the national government, the media, or social media. My employer, again and again, is the central focus of belief in this society. Government is underperforming. It is not simply about the vaccine. It is also across so many areas that traditionally government has been counted on to lead in. So I think you'll be stunned by this slide. Across a series of societal challenges, business is seen as doing better than government. Of course, driving economic growth, that's a given. But on health and safety, guarding information quality, addressing systemic inequality, improving the healthcare system, ensuring the education system, addressing climate change. In fact, it's business having to be Atlas holding up the world because its partner, government, is failing. It's partly failing government because its leaders are seen as less honest and credible than a year ago. And whether you're Mr. Modi in India, whether it's the legacy of Trump in the United States, national government leaders have declining trust. So do state and local government leaders. It's the only group of these six government leaders that had declining trust from a year ago. There is a great divergence, however, on whether government can be trusted to lead in the long run. In the developing markets, there's basic belief in government's ability, 2-1 over business. Meanwhile, in the developed world, it's almost nihilism. A third of the people say, I don't trust anybody to lead us into a better future. 20% government, 14% business. So you can see this distinction. Business. Here we are, the institution burdened by great expectations. What do we mean by that? Well, specifically, there's big pressure for business to take on societal challenges. What I want to show you in particular, though, is this overall 66% say more or less our country will not be able to overcome these challenges without businesses' involvement. But look at the gray part of the bar. That's the people whose opinions have changed in the last year. The number of people who believed in business has doubled because of the pandemic. Business is central to the solution. Employees have risen to the top of the charts as now the most important stakeholder. We started to see this a bit more than a year ago in last March's study about COVID. Treatment of employees became key to a company's trust, whether they were being furloughed and treated well or whether they were giving PPE. Now we see that, in fact, in the world, the most important stakeholder group becomes the employee. This has very important consequences. Why? Because the employees, remember, I always do this. This is the pyramid of authority. It's been flipped upside down. 8 of 10, the employees expect their companies to speak up and act on societal issues, vaccine hesitancy, climate change, automation, infodemic, et cetera. 80% employees as activists. On top of that, the public wants CEOs to prioritize societal issues. This is an eye chart, but the universal is gender and ethnic pay equality. Also, that their company is trusted. Fair share of tax becomes important. Reducing carbon footprint is generally quite important. So again, it's the employees. It's also the public putting pressure on the CEO. Further, there's more support for CEOs to prioritize societal issues. Now, there's also pressure for CEOs in some countries to prioritize political issues. Now, the distinctions, examples, societal issues, DE&I, societal, health, societal, voting rights, political, abortion rights, gun control, political. In some countries, there's a big push across both social and political, France, Germany, Brazil. CEOs have generally been absent from all these debates in the last year. So society, the employees and others are saying, come on, do what your colleagues in the US and the UK have done. Speak up, speak out, represent us. In the US and the UK, CEOs have done so. But What we see in the U.S. for the first time is the sense that CEOs have gone too far on political issues. And so what I thought that I would do before I close is just read you from a column yesterday in Fortune, the CEO of Dow. We do need to address climate change. We do need to reduce climate emissions, carbon emissions. We do need a more inclusive society. We can't stay polarized. If business can be a leader and help bridge the divide between two diametrically opposed political parties, then why shouldn't we take a shot at that? This is the central question of this study. What is societal? What is political? It is something that our panel will address shortly. So, I do want to leave you with hope, because this has been a fairly dire study. 2-1, people believe this pandemic will lead to valuable innovations that changes lives for better in healthcare systems, in innovation, in how we work, in accelerating the development of technologies and attention to climate change. So there is a silver lining. I'd like to close as follows. I want to tell all of you to tell your CEOs, beware the pedestal. Business has absolutely been invaluable in this pandemic, but business can't solve all of these societal issues on its own. That would be a mistake. Let's focus, as point two, on areas of comparative advantage. Well, where is that? Job training. If jobs are going to be automated, let's retrain people. Fair wages. Innovation as to the workplace and the work week. Continue to lead on DE&I, inclusion, sustainability. Third, employees are job one. We have to prioritize informing them, giving them a voice, listening to them, and making them our most important stakeholder. Fourth, it is absolutely urgent that government be responsible for foundational challenges. Example, vaccination, return to workplace, privacy and security, income inequality, climate change. Business can do its part, but government must do its part as well. So with that, I'd like to introduce Kirsty Graham, and she'll take it from here with our panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Richard, for summarizing that data. And I think it is really interesting data. I'm joined by a terrific panel to talk about these findings and the complex landscape that all institutions, but particularly business, is grappling with and being forced to navigate. So let me introduce them now. We have Peggy Johnson, CEO of Magic Leap, Michael Posner, Director of the Center for Business and Human Rights at the NYU Stern School of Business, John Rogers, co-CEO of Ariel Investments, and Dr. David Nabarro, Special Envoy for COVID-19 at the World Health Organization. Thank you to all of you for joining us today. So I'm going to ask some early questions and then I will take yours. So please use the Q&A dialogue box. I do want to let you know that the report is now available on Edelman.com. And later today, we will send a full summary to all attendees. So let's begin by talking about the pressures and the expectations on business to play an ever-increasing role in these societal issues. I'd like to put my first question to you, Mike. It's obviously a very significant turning point in the history of business when you see the plethora of issues that Richard covered. A fundamental change in the way that business is run. And I heard a CEO yesterday saying, you know, the business of business is no longer purely business. Do you think this is sustainable? And how should business be thinking about balancing all these concerns?
Well, first, thanks for having me as part of this. I do think it's inevitably the way the world is going to go. Richard's finding that the role of employees is now central. The views of employees, I think, is going to dictate this in part. They're concerned about income inequality, about an inclusive workforce, about issues like climate change. workplace dignity. And inevitably, to the extent that companies are trying to recruit and maintain a strong workforce, those are going to be pressures that are on them. These are issues that are now very much in the public view. And I think it's no longer enough for companies to say, we have a nice charity program. It's about how are you operating in your own house? How are you operating in terms of the way your business operates? And how much are you responsive to the demands, the growing demands of a workforce that's looking at these issues as a reason to stay or go to work in a different place?
So you make some very good points there, including the role of employees. I actually want to take that thought and take it to you, John, that, you know, when you look at how business has kind of proven itself invaluable during the pandemic, and you look at the long list of issues that CEOs are being expected to engage on, how does business or a CEO choose where to engage or when to speak up?
Well, I think right now the most important thing that CEOs can do is make the office a comfortable place for employees to come back to. I know I've been talking to Melody Hobson, our co-CEO, and we feel deeply that we want to give all of our teammates the freedom to feel comfortable at whatever pace they have. And ultimately, that will pay off over the long run of building trust, because I know we've talked a lot about trust this morning and how important that is. So I think that is the critical thing that I would think is most pertinent, is how you bring people back to work on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah. And can I ask a follow-up to that, John? You know, you sit on a number of corporate boards. This sense that the employee is now the most important stakeholder in a company, are you surprised by that finding? Is that what you are seeing in the work that you are involved in?
Yes, I think that's more and more what I've been seeing. And I've been fortunate to be on boards that where they really, really care deeply about their teammates, the New York Times and McDonald's, Brian's Specialty, and of course, Nike. And it's just been, I've just been privileged to see these legacies, often family businesses that have been built up over time, where they share and have this, again, love for their people, respect for their people, making sure that people have equity, decision-making rights. You know, when you talk to Pat Ryan at Ryan Specialty, he always just talks about his team and all the superstars that are there that have helped build that business. And I've just seen that from time to time. That's what really distinguishes great businesses for the long run, is how they treat their teammates. And I think now it's more important than ever, and people are starting to see that they've got to be on top of this issue.
I think that's a very interesting observation around treating people as humans, and it's one that we've heard a lot about. Peggy, I'm interested in your role as CEO at Magic Leap. How have you seen that piece, that element of the employee, and, you know, showing concern and empathy as a CEO now becoming a very big conversation in the workplace? How have you seen that play out at Magic Leap?
Well, it's been interesting. You know, I was very encouraged by the trust survey. It found that I think it was almost 2/3 of the people are optimistic that the pandemic will lead to valuable innovations and positive changes in how we work. And I think as the head of a tech company, that's very encouraging to hear that. And I think, you know, our role has been using our technology to try and navigate this pandemic. And, you know, things changed so quickly overnight. We were so wholly dependent on video conferencing. And so I think maybe that helped some of the trust be rebuilt, because certainly big tech has had a challenging few years, but that trust is starting to build again, that these tools can help us navigate challenging times like a global pandemic. I think going forward, one of the things that we think about here at Magic Leap, so we build augmented reality devices, so you still see your physical world and we can augment digital on top of that. And when we think about sort of the world we're going into, this hybrid world where we'll be sometimes working in the office, sometimes working at home, we think a lot about how to make that the best environment for our employees. And I think augmented reality can play a role in that, to try and to have a better, more of a physical meeting feeling, even if you're at your home or sitting in your living room and not in work. And so that's something that we've been spending a lot of time on to try and to improve that post-pandemic world even more when we're in that hybrid environment.
So, you know, when you make those comments, Peggy, it also makes me think about what comes through in the survey and what is also being talked about, which is the unequal recovery. And earlier in the week, we saw the Deputy Secretary General of the UN say that this was the inequality virus. You know, we have China growing at 18.3%. We have economists here in the US talking about a potential boom. And yet, if you look at the developing world and you also look at where the virus is in some parts of the developing world, this shrinking of the middle class. I also think that COVID's had a disproportionate impact on women and those who were already the most vulnerable or who were in sort of the informal part of the economy. So I'm interested, Mike, a question for you, and then David, I'd love to bring you in here. What can business do about this inequality? What should leaders be thinking about?
Well, I think one of the hardest things is to adjust to the fact that we have now the greatest income inequality in generations. The gap between the CEO and the average employee has ballooned. And I think inevitably it requires tough choices. Companies have to look at how they're operating. What's their business model? Are they addressing issues like wages and benefits? Those are things that do matter to workers. And ultimately, as we see this gap growing, I think it leads to a quite dangerous situation where workers feel a sense disempowered and taken advantage of. And I think for people running companies, these are issues they've got to take to heart. Income inequality is driving a lot of the populism and rage that we see in the United States and Britain and in so many other countries.
So I see a number of you nodding on this. David, I'm very interested in your perceptions, where you sit at the WHO and the issues that you have been dealing with globally on the pandemic. Yeah. How would you recommend that business thinks about its role in addressing inequality going forward?
Thanks a lot. Thank you for teeing the question up in that way. Everybody, the first thing I need to say just before we get into the discussion is, although things feel a lot better in the United States than they were 3 or 4 months ago, don't think that this pandemic is calming down all over the world. In fact, in my view, it's more ferocious than ever. The virus is moving into rural areas in many poorer countries. The numbers, I'm afraid, are really serious underestimates of what's happening. And the level of distress, suffering and death is just enormous. You read about it when you are perhaps picking up the news from particularly India, and some of it is very graphic. But the same stories are coming through now from Argentina, from other countries in Latin America, particularly Colombia and Peru, a bit Bolivia. Then in the Caribbean, islands like Trinidad and Tobago, very heavily affected. Going into Eastern Asia, Malaysia, Papua New Guinea, parts of Indonesia, and now Taiwan struggling a bit, but they'll get on top of it. What I want to say is, Kirsty, this is now global, deep, and looks like it's going to be extremely long. Probably it's going to be forever. That there are some of us who think that this virus won't ever go away. And that what we'll have to do is to build the necessary systems in place to keep this virus back, to keep it at bay. Firstly, we must remember that the virus is the problem and that people are the solution. Of course, governments help people. Technology helps people. But it is people. And that's why this extraordinary report by Edelman really is helpful, because it's bringing us to the reality that people are what makes the difference. And lastly, just everybody, please remember that COVID is a mild problem for the rich and is a horrendous problem for poor. And I mean people on incomes of less than, say, $15, $20 a day. Poor people. That's where the virus is most deeply entrenched. So to business leaders, I totally agree with what came through the survey. It sort of hits my deep instinct that you are at the heart of helping to come through this, because everybody knows what you stand for. And you do stand, you stand for actually running your businesses well, and you are valued for it. Whereas governments have got multiple different objectives, and they give out confusing stuff. But please don't forget about the inequity. When you've got problems with your P&L and you're having to reduce costs, don't just sack all the lower paid staff as a way of saving money and keep the better paid staff on, because it's the lower paid, those really poor people in some cases, who are suffering the most as a result of this pandemic. So we do need, as well as looking at how our business is run, to pay attention to those questions at the end in Richard's presentation, actually addressing the problems of society is unavoidable. It's not a case of yes or no. It's unavoidable, and we're all part of it.
So thank you, Dave. That is a really good call out. And I want to take that to both to the others, but I'm going to start with you, John. You know, when you think about CEOs and boards, and we see from the survey that trust has gone local, but also we have to recognize that there are different issues across the world, and the CEO has to be cognizant of global and local. How does the CEO calibrate that?
Well, I think a couple of things, but I think the really most important thing right now today, and it just was discussed, you know, things are so disproportionate around the world. Who's been the most impacted by this horrendous virus? And we are a rich nation here in the United States. And so I think CEOs can be more outspoken around the fact that we need to share our vaccines with the world. This is a once in a hundred year event. And so therefore making sure that we are maybe sharing, you know, patents, sharing information, sharing data, helping these countries be able to stand up their own factories to provide these very, very important viruses that's a critical part in the world's history. And so I'm very, you know, much of a capitalist, and I understand the importance of patent protection. And I think smart people can figure out ways to make sure that intellectual property is maintained by the corporate world, but at the same time, make some exceptions of generosity during this once in a hundred year pandemic that's impacting so many people so profoundly. And if CEOs are out there talking about this, I think it will build trust around the world and impact the world in meaningful ways and save hundreds of thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of lives.
So Mike, Piggy, in the worlds that you, the spheres that you operate in, how do you think business can help address these inequalities? Peggy? Mute.
Sorry, the bane of our existence, right? You're on mute. But, you know, as John was saying, the sharing of data, I think, is so important. And just as a technology company, we have these powerful tools that we can point at problems to solve. And you know, and just hearing David say this pandemic may continue to be around. This virus isn't going to just go away. How can technology use the tools they have that maybe previously were pointed at business problems to solve societal problems? I think one thing is we can assess and analyze all of the data sets that we've been able to gather through the pandemic, and we'll be in a better position to react to a pandemic in the future or a resurgence of this virus, because all of the data is there, you know, and we saw countries, some countries, you know, did lockdowns early, some did them in the middle, some did them later. The data is going to show perhaps the best path to navigate. And so that's what excites me, that we have these data sets that we can point to powerful, you know, AI algorithms towards and uncover and surface how to navigate the next pandemic. We've got the tools and we've got the data, and we just have to point them at the right at the right societal issues like this. And so that's the hope, that we can take these tools and have quite a good outcome ahead of the next pandemic that we may face.
And you've touched on data and preparedness, and I actually want to come back to that as a bucket of issues. But Mike, any comments on the role of business in the inequality issues?
Yeah, just to come back to something Richard said, focus on each industry, each company should focus on their comparative advantage. There's not a one-size-fits-all answer to your question to me, but think about, you know, if you're running a global company that has a supply chain, what's happening in the workplace halfway across the world, where some of these issues of inequality are extreme? How do you deal with inclusiveness, even sustainability, some of the environmental issues which disproportionately affect people on the low end of the spectrum? Each company should develop, and each industry should develop, their own standards. Be very specific. What are the things we're doing, contributing to society? How is our business run? And what are the things that we need to do differently to address these issues of inequality in the way we run our own company and the way our industry functions? Work with competitors, but do it on an industry by industry basis.
So some great, very specific guidance coming through here. I'm weaving in questions as I get them. But one area I do want to talk about is this notion of preparedness. And actually a question for you, David. I saw that the report commissioned by the WHO on the global response to the pandemic recently came out. I'm curious if you can summarize sort of how do we make sure we're better prepared? What will happen from here in terms of questions around data, questions around systems, around leadership, and around funding? What do we need to be thinking about for preparedness?
Thanks a lot. And everybody, what happened was that the WHO was instructed by its owners, which are 193 different governments, to commission an independent review of how the pandemic started, how the pandemic progressed, and how everybody involved has responded to the pandemic. The review into how the pandemic started is very contentious, is still ongoing. I want to put that to one side. The independent review of the pandemic's progress was led by the former Prime Minister of New Zealand, Helen Clark, and then the former president of Liberia, Ellen Johnson Sirleaf. And they really did not pull their punches. Firstly, they said it could have been dealt with more quickly at the beginning if WHO had had more powers and was not all the time having to fit in with whatever individual governments was telling it to do. They said it could have been dealt with for the whole world much better if countries had moved when they were informed of what was happening in February, but when they had a chance to move. Most countries moved in March or April or even May, by which time the virus had had a chance to come into their countries and get stuck in and cause trouble. By moving too slowly, many countries have ended up with a lot of virus on board, and as soon as movements restart, the pandemic kicks off. So the review said it's partly the fault of national governments. It's not just all the problem of WHO. And then thirdly, the report has said there needs to be a much better high-level stewardship of how the world deals with these issues, the creation of a new head of state pandemic council linked to better funding for the international system. I think my only concern, Kirsty, is that perhaps one part that is still not fully understood is that it's not just governments, it's not just international organizations, it's business, it's civil society, local authorities, community organizations that are going to be the key to the future, especially when it comes to dealing with future pandemics. I didn't see that part adequately in this report, and I'd love to see more emphasis on that, because I will say it again and again and again. People are the solution. And technology can help.
And David, you make a really good point in here, because it comes through not just in the survey, but in our one earlier, that there is an expectation and also a recognition of the value of partnerships across institutions.
Yeah.
So I want to take what you just said and turn it to John. John, you know, when you're sitting in the boardroom and you think about risk preparedness and boards having to think about risk mitigation and the plethora of issues that came across the bow very quickly, supply chain issues, PPE, the health of workers, how is the boardroom thinking about risk preparedness going forward after what we've seen in 2020?
Well, I think one of the things we are focused on, of course, is, you know, this pandemic and making sure that we're prepared for the next time if something horrific like this ever happened. I know the results show that 70% of Americans think that we're going to have another pandemic. And so it is a big risk that people are focused on in the boardroom. But I also think this income inequality issue that we've talked about, that's been also, of course, enhanced or not, or just brought to the forefront because of George Floyd's assassination, what's happened here. There is a real risk that if we don't find a way to have more income equality, we don't find a way to hit the wealth gap to shrink, particularly around Black and brown people, there are risks that down the road, the protests will get larger and larger if we don't make progress over the next 5-10 years, and that companies will be being boycotted, people will be showing up, shutting down industries and companies that don't get it and haven't made progress on these issues. So I think it's a very important risk for us in this day and age to be on top of that and making sure that we are treating all of our employees with the proper respect and trying, again, to help solve this wealth gap we have and the income inequality that's in our country.
And your response then, John, just goes to an issue that I want to, a question that we have. And it's a really good one. I know that you all have been thinking about it in the various roles you're in. So I'll let any of you tackle this first. Employees may want their CEO to take a stance, but we're seeing whatever the issue, political or social, half employees are likely to disagree with the stance due to people being so divided. Does the polarization of the public and employees factor into the takeaways of this research and what a CEO should be doing on these issues? So it's that balance of the political and the social and how to weigh it up. Who would like to tackle that first?
Well, I think one thing that Richard said early, I think CEOs and companies are on safer ground if they're responding to what he called social issues relating, again, to which go directly to the heart of the business. These aren't optional issues, in my judgment. They're things that companies have to respond to because they really go to how the companies are running, how they're making a profit, their core business activity. But the other thing I would say that I think is critical here is dealing with what you guys are calling the information crisis. We are living in a world where people come to all of these discussions from a different fact base because social media is so itself so divisive. And I would say, you know, this isn't just a problem for Facebook and Google. It's a problem for any company that has advertising dollars spent on social media. And I think companies have not been attentive enough to the model in which extreme views get lots of attention, draw people to the sites, which provides more advertising dollars to those companies. I think it's also the responsibility of any company in the global marketplace that's advertising on Google or Facebook to say, we want to make sure that we're not contributing. In fact, we want to urge a greater attention to truth and honesty in these on these sites, which will, I think, depolarize and make it easier to have honest conversations based on facts.
I was just going to add, I think it's too much to expect CEOs to weigh in on all issues. But in this time where these critical issues are around, again, the wealth gap, but also around the racial issues that our country faces, some of the challenges we're facing internationally, I think it is important for CEOs to speak out in the spirit of what the late Congressman John Lewis always talked about. When you see something that's not fair, that's not right, we all have a moral responsibility you know, to speak up, speak out, make good trouble. And I think it ultimately will help a 21st century company be successful when the CEO is speaking out around these such important moral issues of the day. And customers will care about it. More and more customers are coming to places where they see the institution as a progressive institution. And next generation employees, young people, really want to be with a company that gets it and that's woke and understands it. So if you're trying to hire the best people, have the best customers, please, folks on Wall Street, I think speaking out at the right time makes a lot of sense.
So, Peggy, I'm curious from the perspective of being in the tech universe, the comments that John and Mike just both made around the infodemic and the role of tech, what are your perspectives on this?
Well, what we've found is if we can point our technology towards some of these issues, employees get behind it. They get passionate about using our tools to solve for some of the societal issues. So, for instance, reskilling. We found ourselves using the technology during the pandemic when we couldn't be physically down at our factory in Guadalajara, Mexico. So we used our devices to continue to train and bring people up to speed. And there was an aha moment about we can take this and use it as a reskilling ability across all sorts of enterprises. And you know, people who lost jobs during the pandemic are going to need this type of ability so that they can be retooled towards something where they can continue to make a living. And so that's what's gotten our employees most excited. And then I think the other thing is the issue about sustainability and climate change. This technology also allows you to not be on planes as much. If we can, replicate a physical meeting, a face-to-face meeting, nearly as good as being there with this technology, I think we'll all be getting on planes a lot less. You know, how often have all of us flown across the country for a two-hour meeting? I don't think that's going to happen as much. So if we can get more comfortable with technologies that keeps us in place, I think that's one factor toward having a more sustainable world.
And actually, that is a really interesting perspective in terms of raising climate change. And I want to pivot actually to you, David, on, it strikes me that the global health implications of climate change and is now being recognized by people as being at the top of the agenda of concerns. You know, what is the conversation in the WHO around that? Where that's going next? And can I also ask you to make some comments on the finding around concerns about mental health, not just physical health, but the mental health implications post-COVID?
Thanks a lot. Some big pieces in your questions. And first of all, there's absolutely no doubt that the virus, as well as responses to it, have had massive impacts on so many features of people's lives. But perhaps the most important is impact on mental well-being. Two things. Long COVID affects about 1 in 20 people who get COVID with symptoms. Long COVID is frequently associated with inability to concentrate and sometimes reduced capacity to handle stress. So therefore, we've got a direct impact of the virus on mental health, plus, of course, the efforts to restrict movement and sometimes to even stop all activities in a region altogether as part of trying to get it under control also has a direct impact on the mental health of people. And it's all ages, children, adolescents, youngsters, middle age and old. Second point is to say that we're also picking up masses of evidence that there is a big increase in mental ill health associated with the reality of climate change. People with mental illness are already shown to be more affected by periods of heat. And we've also, in addition, got vast amounts of information about the mental health impact of other climate things like storm surges and disasters and droughts. Overall, this is leading us to say that really, we need to not only consider the physical health impact of the various crises that are advancing, but to hold on to the fact that this is also sending people literally out of their minds to a rather greater extent than has ever happened before.
And I think that is going to be very important for business to think about the mental health of their employees. And you've seen many businesses take extraordinary initiatives, I think, in the past year to recognize that. I want to move to a lightning round for each of you. Just a couple of quick questions. We've covered so much, and I'm also conscious that the data, there are so many places to talk about. But I'm going to start with you, John. What do you know now that you wish you knew at the start of the pandemic? And how is that going to influence you as a leader going forward?
You know, I think what the pandemic did for me was just reinforce the core set of values that we believe in Ariel. You know, we're long-term investors. And, you know, Warren Buffett, the greatest investor of all time, always talks about last century, the Dow Jones started at 66 and ended at over 11,000. And of course, we had a pandemic. We had two world wars. We had a Great Depression. We had the war in Vietnam. All these challenges faced our country, but we have the best capitalist democracy in the world, and we get through our problems. So even though this was catastrophic and it changed so many lives in so many extraordinarily heartbreaking ways, it reinforces that we are a great, great country that figures this out. The way that we got our vaccines out so quickly and effectively beat all the deadlines that people could have imagined. And so there's many other things like that that happened, the way people came together to help make this, solve this problem for our country. So it just reinforced them, believe in America for the long run, think long term, don't get swept up in the short term crisis.
Thank you. Peggy, for you.
I think for me, just this openness to the benefits of a hybrid working model. You know, I came up through the tech industry. I've been in this industry for 35 years, and everything was always done on the campus. And I just remember juggling three kids while I was being an engineer in those years. And I think we need to embrace what we were taught during the pandemic, that we can make it work. And there's going to be times when people are, you know, challenged with elderly parents at home or young kids, and allowing some flexibility in our working model has huge benefits. And I hope that that does continue post-pandemic.
Thank you. David?
Well, I've been talking a lot about the importance of reflecting in on and then celebrating the power of people. But I go further than that. Humans are great, but humans are greatest when they combine their intellectual, emotional, and instinctive energies. Then they can achieve extraordinary transformation. And we've seen this such a lot in responses to the pandemic all over the world. We find it every day, incredible tales of groups of people working together to make results happen. So all the points that came through at the end of the presentation about the constant need to link sideways and to build collective action just seems to be brought out by what we're seeing every day in relation to the pandemic.
Thank you, David. And Mike?
Yeah, just adding to what's been said, one thing that's really been striking to me is the resilience of the human spirit, the ability of people to innovate, even in the most dire consequences, dire circumstance. The fact that we got a vaccine out in less than a year and it's spread, it's now been administered to hundreds of millions of people. One reason people turn to business is because businesses have that innovative spirit. And it says to me, if businesses can, in this kind of a dire emergency, can do so much, the future, as we come out of the emergency, ought to be bright, and we ought to use that same energy and intuition and innovativeness to make the world better going forward.
So I think that's a really terrific way to close, actually, Mike. I think that's an optimistic note. And I think this whole notion of how business has shown up in the past year and what leadership looks like, and quite honestly, the partnership that is so necessary, irrespective of which institution you're in or whatever type of leader you are. Is it political? Is it business? Is it media? I think there are huge takeaways for leadership in the course of 2020. And this whole concept that we have a responsibility to build back better. We have some incredible learnings from this, and it's upon all of us and the work that we do do that. So I want to thank you for your time today. I want to thank you for the insights and your candor. I know you all have a lot of other things going on, so thank you very much. And I'm going to turn back to you, Richard, to close us out.
So what did we learn today? We told you five important facts. One, that the mass class divide has become exacerbated because of different responses to the pandemic. In other words, that the poor have been more horribly affected than the wealthy, that stock markets are buoyant. In fact, a lot of the perception could be that there have been more billionaires created, and that the wealthy are just doing great out of all this government subsidy and flooding the market with money. So watch out for a repeat of what happened after the Great Recession vis-a-vis trust in business, because it's all very sort of fragile. So mass class divide. The second is pandemic stress syndrome. I've invented the term, but the consequence of this pandemic on mental health, on a frankly, unwillingness to sort of revert right back to where we were before all of this, because we're scared. And we have mental health issues. We have new concerns about climate. So the pandemic stress syndrome is real and long lasting. All of us have been scarred one way or another. The third, we have a lack of quality information. The infodemic continues. The media continues to underperform. The perception is that they provide stories that are clickbait and that, you know, heat up the left or the right, and that, you know, people are looking for facts in the middle, and actually they're looking to their employer to provide quality information because they can't get it elsewhere. The fourth is that government is underperforming. And it's true that there was a rise in the US and the UK, but not that big. Interestingly, there wasn't that big a decline either in Brazil or in India in trust in government, though in India, for the first time, business is more trusted than government. That's significant. But there weren't huge rises or falls. So in short, we are looking for government to perform better on getting vaccines in people's arms. But it's much more than that. The chart that we showed you on eight societal issues where business unanimously was considered as more competent is significant. Lastly, that business is Atlas holding up the world at the moment. And that is a untenable long-term proposition, ladies and gentlemen. We have to get to a place, for example, on return to work, whether John and I are very involved in Chicago, whether it's in New York, the only way we're going to get people to come back to the workplace is if business and government do this together. There's no way that people are going to get back commuting, taking planes, anything else, until there's an agreed protocol with people like Dr. Nabarro having guaranteed it in a way, and that we have to all work together on this. It's not just business can do this alone. So I leave you with the thought that I have in my blog post of today, which is business is actually Odysseus. And it's in the Odyssey, and there's a moment in time where he's trying to steer his ship between two monsters, Scylla and Charybdis. And basically, you have to navigate the winds and the course, because if you go too far to the right, it's Charybdis, and it's too far to the left, it's Scylla. And the left-hand side is complacency and saying nothing. On the right-hand side is trying to overdo it. And what I'm arguing for is that business take its time and choose its issues well, areas of comparative advantage, areas where it's clear that society needs us, wages, retraining, sustainability. Also, partner with government on issues such as health systems, education. We can't do it alone. So thank you all very much for listening. We will be having another one of these in a month about the role of brands in society. Please tune in. Thank you, panelists. You're my heroes. And thank you, Kirsty. You're the greatest. Bye, team.